people held their breath when they heard of Jesse's death, wondered how he came to die. For the big reward, the little Robert Ford got Jesse James on the fly. It was Robert Ford, that dirty little coward. I wonder how he does feel. For he ate Jesse's bread and then he slept in Jesse's bed. Then he laid Jesse James in his grave. Jesse leaves a wife that'll mourn all her life. The children that he loved will pray. For Bob Ford the coward that shot Mr. Howard and laid Jesse James in his grave. Jesse was a man, a friend to the poor. He'd never see a man suffer pain. But with his brother Frank, he robbed the Springfield Bank and stopped the Glendale train. It was his brother Frank that robbed the Gallatin Bank and carried the money from the town. It was in this very place they had a little shake, and they chopped up and beat to the ground. Jesse leaves a wife that'll
This is
off.
Jesse James, Jr., the only son of that famous outlaw, Jesse James. He has just received a telegram. Franklin B. Coates, noted author and playwright, who is collaborating with Jesse James Jr. in writing a new book. Jesse James Jr. welcomes his friend to his home. Jesse James Jr. stands for Mrs. James. Mrs. James meets Franklin B. Coates. Robert Standing, a New York sportsman, is making a transcontinental trip by aeroplane. His fuel supply runs low, and he is forced to land in unfamiliar country. Fate brings him to Lucille, the daughter of Jesse James, Jr., who gladly gives him the information he is after. James' home, Mr. Coates and Jesse James, Jr. are discussing the final chapters of their book. Lucille returns from a jaunt over the bridle path and is introduced to Franklin B. Coates. Telling glances exchanged between Lucille and Robert show that romance is in the air. Many months later, we find Lucille in the garden of her home, often dreaming of the handsome young sportsman in his aeroplane, and wondering if they would ever meet again. Robert Standing's thoughts were also of her, for here a strange car is seen coming up the driveway to the James home. Robert Standing has come back for his lady love, and how Lucille has welcomed him. invites him into her home to meet her father. Robert Standing is introduced to Jesse James Jr. Robert tells her dad of his love for Lucille and asks for her hand in marriage. Robert Standing is here told by Jesse James that Lucille, the girl he loves, is a direct descendant of the man who was branded as the most hunted outlaw in American history. And before consent to the marriage of Lucille can be given, Robert must first acquaint himself with the true facts concerning the life of Jesse James. And having handed Robert Standing a copy of the book, Jesse James Under the Black Flag, he asked him to read the story. And if Robert still wants to marry Lucille, he will consent gladly. And so we leave Robert reading the life of Jesse James. Started during the early days of the Civil War, when conditions along the Missouri border had reached the stage of guerrilla warfare. Federal soldiers burned homes. The Southerners, desperate, organized under the able leadership of Charles William Cantrell. It was about this time when Jesse James, a mere lad of 17, but looking older, sought to join Quantrell's guerrillas. Jesse James shows his card death. He tells of the Federals torturing his stepfather and sending his mother and sister to prison. Now Jesse James wants revenge. Quantrell tells Jesse James that misdeeds such as he relates are not sanctioned by the Union Army. They are the work of individuals who are severely punished when found out. However, it was misdeeds like these that forced him and many others to seek protection under the Black Flag. The Black Flag, a banner raised by Quantrell, which meant we seek no quarters and will give none. Jesse James swears allegiance to the Black Flag. Jesse James two guns and a bullet belt, making him a full-fledged member of the guerrillas. Bill Anderson, Quantrell's lieutenant, knows Jesse's brother Frank and tells him he is with Dave Poole in Lafayette County. Younger, one of the most daring scouts under the Black Flag, returned from scout duty. Murdoch pretends to be at work and tries to get an earful. Quantrell catches him and orders him away. Cole Younger is dispatched to obtain information at a nearby Union encampment. So Jesse James is given his first assignment under the Black Flag. Jesse James and Cole Younger ride to the home of Mrs. Sam Clifton, a young mother who risked the dangers of warfare to aid the Southern cause. Jesse James goes into the house to get Mrs. Clifton. Cole Younger and Jesse James tell Mrs. Clifton of the plans for the evening. Thank you. between the Clifton homestead and the spot where the Union soldiers were billeted for the night, Jesse James stops in his brush to disguise himself as a Federal. Cole Younger stands guard with guns drawn, ready to warn against any impending danger. It doesn't take Jesse long to get into his disguise, and our little party is soon off for the Federal headquarters. Federals in a friendly fashion and takes his place at one of the tables. Jesse James, playing drunk, and Mrs. Clifton come in a moment later. Jesse goes into the unoccupied room while Mrs. Clifton flirts with the commanding officer. The commanding officer follows Mrs. Clifton into the room where Jesse James pretends to be asleep. Mrs. Clifton tells the officer that he is being tortured by the guerrilla warriors for being a Northern sympathizer and wants to get under the protecting wing of the Union Army. The commander tells her that 200 men are stationed at a garrison in Plattsburg, Missouri, and that he will take her there. He also tells her that his men will attack the guerrillas tomorrow night. The commander leaves for the moment, and Cole Younger is afforded an opportunity to escape without arousing the suspicions of the Federals. Getting Jess and Mrs. Clifton, the trio make a quick getaway. Commander returns, finds Jesse and Mrs. Clifton gone, and sends out an alarm. Down the road, Cole Younger and Jesse James meet Mrs. Clifton and her colored servant. And after escorting them safely home, Cole and Jesse return on to Quantrill's camp to make a report of the evening's activities. Jesse James tells Quantrill all about the 200 men at Plattsburg that planned to attack the guerrillas. Quantrill decides to beat the Federals at their own game. Federal sentry strikes the guerrillas. The sentry reports to the commanding officer. The alarm, on your toes, the guerrillas are coming. Thank you. Jesse James risked his life to save a pal. And with the moon high in the sky, the guerrilla warriors returned to their camp with another victory to their credit. Back in camp, Bill Anderson praises the deeds and daring of Jesse James to Quantrell. Sometime later, Jesse James is shot from ambush. He is helped back to camp by Anderson and Younger. Anderson and Younger take Jesse James to his mother's home for treatment of his wounds. Days of anxiety, and then one day, Jesse James is able to sit up. He asks his mother how long he has been ill, and is told he has been there a long time. He inquires of Cole Younger, and learns that Cole has gone home to visit his mother and sisters, and to see what this new General Order Number 11 really means. Cole Younger, on his way home, stops to read all about General Order Number 11. All along the road, he met Southerners who had deserted their homes, leaving everything behind, fleeing General Order Number 11. At the Younger home, a squad of federal soldiers arrived. The officer demands to know where Cole Younger can be found, but Cole's sisters are unable to give the officer any information. The federal officer tells Mrs. Younger, Cole's mother, that he is here to enforce a new General Order Number 11, which means that they will not be able to house Confederate soldiers or Southern sympathizers any longer, and Cole's mother and sisters are ordered from their homes. Mrs. Younger and her daughters leave just as the Federals set fire to their home. All this while, Cole Younger watches from his distant hilltop, powerless to do anything to save his home. Cole Younger starts back for the home of Jesse James. He is sighted by the Federals, who give chase. Younger escape. At the camp, Major Rogers is waiting to reprimand his lieutenant. A guerrilla warrior stands guard at the James home. News has reached them of General Order Number 11, and arrangements are being made for the women folks to leave. Jesse's mother and sister are sent to a safer place. While Bill Anderson is talking to Jesse James, Cole Younger arrives and tells them that the Federals have burned his home, and that he will avenge this wrong. Anderson and Cole Younger helped Jesse James, still weak from his wound. At the stable, Bill Anderson helped Jesse mount his horse, and the trio will soon start for the camp of Quantrell. At the Quantrell camp, Murdoch is reported to be misusing the name of Jesse James and is ordered from the camp. Navo, Quantrell's Indian messenger, comes with good news. He tells them that Poole and his men are returning tonight. Murdoch swears revenge. Eagle, Chef, and General Boy in the guerrilla camp is out gathering fowl for the feast. For Poole and his men return disguised as Union soldiers. To the camp of Quantrell, still weak from his wound. Quantrell gives Jesse leave to take a long rest. After the winter of 1864, Arch Clements and his men unsuccessfully attempt to surrender. Again, Jesse James is severely wounded. For 2 days, Jesse James lay beside a waterhole, bathing his wound. And then along came a friend who helped him to the home of Judge Bowman. Judge Bowman and his wife shared a true feeling of friendship for Jesse James. And here, Jesse receives the very best of medical attention. And 129 guerrilla warriors ride into the camp of Major Rogers and surrender under the following terms: that each member of the guerrilla band shall retain 2 revolvers, whatever horses he owns, and whatever ammunition is left to him. Major Rogers agrees to these terms and asks all the men who are satisfied to raise their right hands. The men agree unanimously, and Major Rogers pardons them. Jesse is recovering rapidly from his wound. Arch Clements pays Jesse James a visit. He tells Jesse that Dave Poole has surrendered and that all the guerrillas now have their full pardon, with the exception of himself, Jesse James, and one or two others. Jesse tells Clements that he is glad to hear of the surrender. It means that they will all be able to live once again as quiet, law-abiding citizens. Mammy, who had been detailed as Jesse's nurse, orders Jesse back to bed and asks Clement to leave. Mrs. Bowman is giving a reception tonight in honor of the speedy recovery of Jesse James. Miss Zerelda Mims arrives at the Bowman home. Little does she suspect that tonight she will meet the man who will mean much to her in later life. In his bedroom, dreams of becoming a useful citizen once again. Z. Mims is wearing honeysuckle, and the fragrance of the honeysuckle fills the room. Jesse James, still in his room, can smell the honeysuckle and can picture a beautiful girl in his mind. Mammy comes up to see if Jesse is ready to be presented at the reception. Jesse asks Mammy if there is a beautiful girl downstairs wearing honeysuckle and learns that there is. Mrs. Bowman comes up for Jesse and invites him to the reception. Mrs. Bowman and Jesse sit out a dance in the garden. Z. Mims comes into the garden and is introduced to Jesse James. And so Z. Mims enters into the life of Jesse James. In the garden, Jesse tells Z how he adores her and the scent of honeysuckle. And so love enters the life of Jesse James. But this was not the end of his battles and besetments, for unfortunately, Jesse was never allowed to lay down his weapons. To be at peace with the world, Jesse James returns to the home of his mother in Kearney, Missouri. The old folks at home sure join in a grand old welcome for Jesse. Jesse is glad to be home again, and he takes off his guns and bullet belt. And laying them on the table, tells his mother that he will have no further use for them. His only desire is to become a useful and a law-abiding citizen. Jesse also tells his mother about his love for Z. Mims. time he looks out of the window, he sees Dan Askew coming toward the house. Dan Askew, a former federal and now a member of the Home Guard, always meant trouble to the James family. The arrival of Dan Askew brings a grave message. He tells Jesse James that the bank at Liberty has just been robbed of $70,000 and that Jesse is suspected of the crime. A few minutes after Dan Askew has gone, the Home Guards arrive at the James home and demand the surrender of Jesse. Behind the closed door, Jesse asks the Home Guards what they will do with him if he surrenders. And the Home Guards inform Jesse that they are going to hang him. Jesse James tells his mother that he did not commit this crime and will not let the Home Guards take him. And so, quickly donning his guns and bullet belt, his coat and hat, Jesse kisses his mother and sister goodbye and escapes through a rear door of the house. Home, V. Mim arrives to visit the Bowman and learns that the Bowman baby is very ill and that they have sent for Jesse James. When Jesse James arrives at the Bowman home, he is greeted by old Judge Bowman, who tells Jesse that it is an outrage the way the Home Guards are making an outlaw out of him. The elder Bowman girl sees Jesse and goes to get Z. Rushes down to greet Jesse and to take him to the bedside of the Bowman baby. Jesse James loved the Bowman baby. He would do anything she could ask of him. To her, he was always known as Uncle Dick. The Bowman baby was about to undergo a serious operation and wanted to have her dolly Susan, which she had left in the home of a playmate at a nearby farmhouse. Jesse promises the Bowman baby he will get her dolly. Amid the protest of Z. Mims and the Bowman, Jesse goes after the doll. Jesse arrives at the farmhouse and gets the doll. While in the house, Home Guards are torturing a poor woman, trying to find out where Jesse James is. The little girl tells the Home Guards to leave her mother alone, and that Jesse just left with a dolly. Bowman home, Z. Mims, tired of waiting for Jesse, decides to leave. Judge Bowman is about to escort her home when Jesse James comes back safely with a baby doll. Takes the doll to the baby's bedside, and all that night, Jesse knelt by the bedside of the little Bowman baby. holding her tiny hand in his, and in the morning when the crisis was over, Judge Bowman thanked Jesse for his kindness to his daughter. But at this time, something else was to occur that hurt Jesse more than if he had been shot through the heart. The Pinkerton detectives bombed the James home, killing Jesse's little half-brother and badly injuring his aged mother. It was surely a night of horror. It was months before it was safe for Jesse to return to his home. And one night, Jesse's sister Susan heard Jesse signal from without. Susan taps an OK signal on the window, and Jesse comes into the house. Had done to his aged mother and heard also of his half-brother's death. He vowed that from now on it would be a limb for a limb and a life for a life. Jesse and a companion have booked passage on a river steamer and go aboard the boat. But they are recognized by two men who know of the large reward for his capture and plan to apprehend him. Shows a bit of courtesy to an old woman traveling with a young child, and a little girl presents Jesse with a flower. Afternoon aboard the boat, Jesse is invited into a card game, which later proves to be part of the plot to capture Jesse. Jesse catches the dealer cheating and, suspicious of the men he is playing with, draws his gun and orders the card party to throw up their hands. While his companions strip the players of their guns, Jesse leaves the scene of the card game. One of the men draws a gun only to have it shot out of his hand by Jesse. With his companion following close behind, Jesse manages to get to the top deck. The women approach, and Jesse, seeing no other means of escape, jumps into the river with his companion. And they swim away to safety.
Thank you.
fortunate to go ashore near the camp of their old friend Chief Red Fox. This shows Chief Red Fox himself portraying the character. The Indian chief had gotten two blankets and is now helping the men to the tepee where they can dry their clothes. The Chicago and Alton train robbery, which was credited to Jesse James and his gang. After stopping the train, order the passengers out. After stripping them of their valuables, the bandit leader hands one of the ladies a car. Next, the passengers are ordered back into the train. The band of robbers make their escape. One woman tells her that he could not see Jesse James, but Jesse would never insult a lady. Happened, Jesse was at the camp of Chief Red Fox many miles away. A week later, Jesse James calls upon an old friend for the purpose of buying a horse named Stonewall with a reputation of being as fast as the wind. Jesse pays part cash and gives a note for the balance. The owner of the horse asks Jesse how he can collect on the note should Jesse refuse to pay him. Jesse smiles and said he really didn't know. Jesse enters Stonewall in a horse race at Independence, Missouri.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Junior Humphreys, the world's youngest cowboy, and the first event of the rodeo.
Hi, everybody.
The next event, Bronc Busting Contest, Buck McKee on Wild Lightning, and Jim Clark on Tornado. Event riding the wild horses, Tex McIntyre on Larkspur. Next event, bulldogging steers, Frank Heat and Dale Fletcher, contestants. Next next event, Rose Hart, famous lady blockbuster on Whirlwind, followed by Buck McKee and Dale Fletcher, horses from Bar Z Ranch. Event steer throwing contest featuring Pee Wee Holmes contestant. Gentlemen, the next final and feature event of the day, the horse race for a $10,000 gold purse. The horse race for a $10,000 gold purse. Let her go.
Detectives on the trail of Jesse suspect that Howard is Jesse James. Jesse James refuses to accept the prize money and tells the judge to donate it to some worthy cause. Stonewall and rides away, but the Pinkertons, feeling that they are on the right trail, will follow Jesse. Flora McCormick assures Z and Susan that no one will ever overtake Jesse on Stonewall. Jesse James is safe to the farmhouse of one of his friends. Having dismounted Stonewall, Jesse goes into the house. Through a window unseen, Jesse can watch the movement of the detective. The pursuing detectives lose Jesse's trail and decide to split and search for him. Jesse leaves the house and hides behind a tree to watch the movement of the detective, who, having lost trail of Jesse, accidentally falls into a ditch and badly hurts his leg. Jesse, now feeling certain that there is no danger, goes to the detective and, taking his gun away, helps him out of the ditch. Thank you. after helping the detective on his horse, empties the shells from the detective's gun and returns it. The detective thanks Jesse for his kindness to him and rides away. Some time later, in the offices of the National Detective Agency, another message is received by the chief of detectives. The chief of detectives orders the arrest and capture of Jesse James, placing a large reward on his head. Outlawed and hunted, Jesse James rode through the country on Stonewall and meets up with a sheriff and his posse. The sheriff tells Jesse that he is hunting Jesse James and his band of men who just held up the Croydon, Iowa bank. Jesse joins the sheriff's posse, so we find Jesse James and the posse ready to hunt for Jesse James. Murdoch goes to the home of Fletcher, a member of his band, who is away, and forcing his way into the house, attempts to take advantage of Fletcher's sister. Jesse James, the sheriff, and the posse have stopped near the home of Fletcher, who has a very shady reputation and is also reported to be a member of the James gang. Murdoch has a struggle with Miss Fletcher and blocks her attempt to get a gun from the wall. Shot by Murdoch. Jesse James enters gun drawn and gets a drop on Murdoch. Fletcher confesses that Murdoch committed robberies using the name of Jesse James, and so Jesse turns Murdoch over to the sheriff. Jesse promises Miss Fletcher that he will send a doctor to dress her brother's wounds as soon as possible. Tree. Night and a gruesome sight frightens the darkies. Jesse James hurries to overtake the posse. Jesse meets the sheriff and his posse again, and the sheriff tells Jesse that the outlaw Jesse James has robbed his last bank. Jesse assures the sheriff that the spirit of Jesse James is hanging high. One of the sheriff's men, a doctor, is dispatched to give treatment to the wounded Fletcher. The remainder of the sheriff's posse leave for their homes, and Jesse continues on his way. Jesse James returns to Z Mims. At all times, he has carried the love of sea in his heart. Secluded spot, Jesse tells Z that his only wish is to be at peace with the world, that he hopes to have her and a home someday. And so Jesse and Z decide to get married. Z day of the wedding of Jesse James to Zerelda Mims at the Mims home. Marriage of Jesse and Z, Jesse led a quiet and uneventful life until that never-to-be-forgotten day in Northfield, Minnesota. Late one afternoon, Jesse James, his brother Frank, the younger brothers, and several others entered the First National Bank in Northfield, Minnesota. This venture was a complete failure. It seemed the town was ready for them. Younger goes back for his brother. He better organizes a posse for immediate pursuit of Jesse James and his gang. The James gang takes to the forest. Decides to split and search the woods for the members of the James gang believed to be hiding there. One of the younger brothers is severely wounded and is barely being kept alive by the little aid Cole can give him. Posse kept closing in on the outlaws, getting nearer and nearer every minute. Jesse and Frank James managed to obtain two horses and agreed to split with the younger. They divide their only wealth, ammunition. Frank and Jesse ride away, and Cole Younger and one of the other outlaws help Charlie Younger, the wounded outlaw, to a safer retreat. and Jesse read one of the many signs posted offering a reward for their capture. Decide to separate to avoid detection. The posse sees only a lap behind them, and the sheriff notices a fresh hoof print and gives chase to Jesse. Jesse is almost overtaken. Jesse hides in a tree, and the posse loses his trail. The younger brothers were still eluding the posse when a little boy innocently gave away the hiding place of the outlaws. The posse proceeds to close in on the younger. One of the outlaws watches the posse ride by, but knows better than to shoot at them. Charlie tells Cole Younger that he hasn't a chance, that they are greatly outnumbered, and that Cole ought to surrender. But a voice seemed to whisper to Cole, "The wages of sin are death." And Cole's only reply was, "Charlie, here is where I die." Charlie answered, "Cole, I can die just as game as you can." This was the younger brother's last stand. Surrender. Many months later, Jesse James led a peaceful life, living with his wife and two children under the assumed name of Howard in St. Joseph, Missouri. The Ford brothers are visiting Jesse, and Jesse arrives with some good news. Now buy a farm where they will all live together in peace. Jesse is so happy, he makes Bob Ford a present of his pearl-handled pistol. Bob Ford had always wanted this gun. The Ford brothers thank Jesse for this gift and leave. Jesse James surely loved his two children. Mrs. James tells Jesse that she feels that Bob Ford and his brother are not his friends. Jesse assures her that the Ford brothers are all right. Later in the afternoon, Jesse returns to his home with the Ford brothers, who, unbeknown to Jesse, were plotting his death in order to secure the large reward. Jesse takes off his gun, belt, and coat and lays them across the bed. Then Jesse, noticing a picture hanging crooked upon the wall, he goes into the next room and gets a brush with which to straighten it. his chance and shoots Jesse in the back with his gun. Jesse James never regained consciousness and died in the arms of his faithful and loving wife. This marked the end of America's Robin Hood. Had read the book and could find no reason why he should not marry Lucille. He now realizes that Lucille is the granddaughter of a man whose true self was as lovable, kind, honest, and law-abiding as any man in the annals of the history of this glorious country. And with this thought in mind, Robert asks Lucille if she will honor him by becoming his wife.